ReZero, Arc 8, Chapter 62, The Power of Love.
The entirety of her body burst into flames, reducing the witch to ash, the awe-inspiring power of the Yang sword that at last had finally been unsheathed from its veil, which had stolen her soul and whose fierce flames had reduced it to naught but cinders, exceeded even Subaru's expectations for his plan. Subaru, this must be the true power of the Yang sword. Not only was this witch cut down, but the crimson flames of the blaze spread to the two other bodies of the witch. Seeing the resultant effect, Subaru could only gasp. Up until now, there had been several situations in which Subaru had witnessed the Yang sword being wielded, but the owner of the Yang sword had always been Priscilla. However, in terms of Abel exceeding Priscilla as a wielder of the Yang sword, there would be no such simple answer. The opponents whom Priscilla had unleashed her Yang sword upon had always been formidable. This time, the witch Sphinx had been a similarly formidable enemy, and in order to defeat her, Abel had made an incredible gamble. In every battlefield, in every possible arrangement of the board, and in every crisis up until now, he had never once utilized the Yang sword. Thus for Sphinx, or rather, for everyone, it had been eliminated as a possibility. In order to bring such a thing to fruition, one could not imagine the nerve required. Vincent, you, what is with that incomprehensible expression? Subaru, I'm just surprised. We've been through so much together up until now, and I'm still easily discovering things about your personality to complain about. Vincent, and here I was wondering what you were going to say. Could it be that you are referring to this card that I had kept unturned? If that is so, are you not also the sort to hatch up plans of this ilk? Subaru, it's not a matter of character on my part, it's okay because it's the result of wit and bravery and cheating. Thinking back to the beginning with the lifeblood ritual, and that time we fought Zika-san and the others at Garal, then when Arakia made her entrance, then our dispute with Yona-san at Chaos Flame and the game of tag with Olbart-san and the entire time we were on the couple dragon carriages. You kept it hidden, Vincent, yes, and, Subaru, yes, and, with the treasured sword of crimson in hand, Abel's shameless affirmation amazed Subaru, but then, in an instant, the pain in his right arm that was broken by Sphinx as a warning came rushing back. As he held his broken arm with tears in his eyes, Beatrice rushed beside him with a Subaru and held her hand over it, using her healing magic. And so, as Beatrice attended to Subaru tenderly, Beatrice, no matter how many times you say it seems it will never have an effect on that man. In fact, perhaps, his ability to feel guilt has probably died, I suppose. He's of the same breed as Roswell. In fact, Subaru, Beatrice, there, that should make it feel a little better, I suppose. Heaping as much verbal abuse as she could upon Abel, Beatrice finished Subaru's medical treatment. The pain still lingered, but the broken bone felt like it had been healed. It could not be moved around too much, and it would take some time to be completely healed, but there existed other priorities. Vincent, shall you be able to save Jamal orally? Beatrice, so long as he's still breathing, I'll do what I can. In fact, this is Betty's duty as Subaru's partner, I suppose. Leaving with these words, Beatrice trotted over to Jamal. After defeating the first Sphinx, three more Sphinxes had appeared, and it was Jamal who had provoked them and in turn received the most injury. The way he had done so, by continuing to hurl abuse that was painful to listen to, had been rather crude, albeit, that too was an act of showing his loyalty to the Emperor. Spiker, wow. Subaru, oh, Spiker, you did a great job. What about your body? It doesn't hurt anywhere? Spiker, oh. With a vigorous nod, Spiker tried to stop his worrying as she smiled. Using his hand to wipe away the dirt from her cheek, he gave her head a pat as a reward for her hard work. Truly, without any doubt, this was a victory that had been gained by everyone here doing their utmost to fulfill their duty. That said, he could not help but acknowledge that Abel's trump card had contributed more than anything else. Subaru, still, I'm gonna be holding a grudge against you for the rest of my life. Vincent, if I have made you say that much, then the one who suggested this must also be satisfied. No matter how reproachful the glare, Abel would ignore it nonchalantly. While his cold nature was infuriating, when it came to the matter of hiding the Yang sword and having the confidence to stick with it, Subaru could do nothing but speak his praise. The fact that Abel was capable of using the Yang sword, but hid that fact, was something that Subaru had only become aware of within the loop where the fight with Sphinx had already started. To put it plainly, it was a level of secrecy of a dead weight. Originally, the only trump card which could have been hoped to stop the great disaster of the Volakian Empire was for Subaru to combine his power with Spiker's star eating. But if Abel's Yang sword could reach the foundation of the souls of the undead, then the story was different. The Yang sword and star eating, the two leading actors in this siege on the undead territory, could be utilized as trump cards in order to defeat the great disaster. Subaru, you, having realized this earlier, decided to join us in this group, right? Spiker, you? Subaru, you see, Spiker, this sly emperor is able to use the Yang sword, and even knew that it might be one of the key items in defeating the zombies. Spiker is the same, right? So, we had to proactively whittle down the zombies by using star eating. What happened then, Spiker? You? Subaru, that's right. The enemy's main forces came after us. And the method we used against that main force was Spiker's star eating. After all, I didn't know what the odds were that there was another method. So, it would be just fine if Spiker could deal with them. But in the event that you couldn't, Spiker, after Subaru concluded his explanation, Spiker's eyes widened and she pointed at Abel's Yang sword. Subaru replied, "That's right." To Spiker's sudden comprehension and patted her head. Alongside Spiker, he looked at Abel as if he was human garbage. Subaru, look, Spiker. Those are the eyes of someone with a completely twisted personality. Your personality has to be pitch black in order to be the Emperor of Volakia. I knew it. Wouldn't it be better to destroy Volakia after all? Vincent, changing sides as soon as the enemy leader has been reduced to ash? You have chosen a terrible time to betray me. Beatrice, you, don't beg us to help save the Empire just to immediately become the head of a rebellion, I suppose. Though they were here out of necessity, the Empire was bad for Spiker's emotional education. Abel was a prime example of this, so outside of a situation such as this, he was the first person that should not be around her. Spiker should be surrounded by more wholesome and refreshing companions she could imitate, such as Emilia and Rem, or Beatrice and Tanza. Subaru, in that case, we need to keep her away from Otto and Roswell as well. As for Nay Summer, I like her, but dealing with more than two people would be tough. Garfield could also be a good influence, but Beatrice, Subaru. The healing over here is almost finished. In fact, Subaru, got it. Following Beatrice's voice, Subaru and the others went towards where Jamal had fallen. But Jamal did not raise his voice at the arrival of Subaru and the others, as he was still splayed out on the ground. Beatrice, for now, his life isn't in any danger, I suppose. But any further treatment will require time, and will also take up Betty's remaining strength. In fact, Subaru, Biko's remaining strength. Like, your remaining mana? Beatrice, indeed, I suppose. There's an irregularity which makes it like a lavish banquet, but it would be reckless to rely on it. In fact, Subaru, irregularity. Hearing Beatrice's answer, Subaru stared down at his hands. What she had called an irregularity, the remaining mana within Subaru's body as Subaru's contracted spirit, the mana that was in Subaru became Beatrice's remaining MP, so in his current condition, the amount of mana being lent to her could indeed be considered an irregularity. Subaru had some ideas as to why this might be the case. One possibility was that the connection between everyone in the Pleiades battalion and Subaru had brought about a positive effect. Another possibility was that infantilization had led to some strange occurrence in Subaru's gate. But in the latter case, it was not likely that Beatrice would be able to understand it, so he felt that the former option was more likely. Subaru, to become stronger because of my connections with everyone, I'm the kind of guy who gets passionate from stuff like that. Beatrice, Subaru, don't worry, Miko. No matter what, I agree that using as much magic as we please probably isn't a good thing, so we should try to conserve it as much as possible. But if we're backed into a corner, while respecting Beatrice's judgment, Subaru stared fixedly at the fallen Jamal. Naturally, they could not abandon him as he was instrumental to their victory. However, if Jamal did not regain consciousness, someone would inevitably have to carry him. Vincent, for the record, I will not be carrying him. Subaru, you beat me to it. You've been on a roll ever since you got that sword, huh? Even though you were a close match with me in that cat fight earlier, you were swooshing and bouncing around. Wouldn't it be trivial for you to carry Jamal? Vincent, even if I could do it, I shan't. Now that Jamal orally has fallen, I ought to be the most agile one present. We are in a position which requires vigilance, so I cannot be carrying baggage. Subaru, don't call him baggage. Fine, I get it. Spiker, Yuao. Angry at the unruly emperor who had given a sound argument, Subaru attempted to carry Jamal. However, Spiker slipped right past him and took the initiative to pick up Jamal's body. The image of a petite girl easily lifting an adult man was painful to watch, even though Spiker was not putting much strain on herself. Subaru, well, that's what it would look like if anyone but you were doing it. What do you think? Vincent, it is a great service. Continue to endeavor as you are. Subaru, you're right. Biko, this guy has no sense of guilt. Beatrice, I already said that, I suppose. Spiker, don't push yourself too hard. In fact, Beatrice sighed at Abel's audacity, and Spiker exclaimed Yu, with a smile in response to her consideration. In fact, it was a relief that Spiker did not seem to find Jamal to be heavy. In any case, although the reality of having defeated the formidable Sphinx was gradually starting to sink in, they could not be completely happy about it. That was because, Vincent, it seems like there's already significance to me having kept my hands free. As Abel said this, he jerked his chin towards a succession of silhouettes approaching the street where Subaru and the others were, as if they had heard the battle with the Sphinx's earlier figures of the undead could be spotted. Subaru grit his teeth at what this meant and the frustrating truth of Abel's words. Thus, the fact of the matter was the undead had appeared here where they were. Beatrice, even after defeating Sphinx, the sacrament of the immortal king hasn't been severed, I suppose. Subaru, damn, the most direct logic that the magic would disappear if the caster were to be defeated seems to be wrong. Biko, this is Beatrice, even though she was corrupted, she was created with the goal of becoming the Witch of Greed, I suppose. Perhaps, she arranged the ritual so that the sacrament of the Immortal King would function even in her absence. In fact, if we don't destroy the system itself, the stone's limitations are still the limits of this country, I suppose. Subaru, I guess that's probably the case. After absorbing what Beatrice had said, Subaru's gaze turned to the northernmost part of the Imperial capital. He looked to the Crystal Palace. That was where Sphinx and her side were based up, so it was the most appropriate location for a symbolic object to be placed. Of course, it was possible that Sphinx, who did not appreciate such romance and drama, had placed its contrivance elsewhere. Vincent, no, there can be no mistaking that it is at the Crystal Palace. Whatever the witch's intentions, if she needed a connection to the stone, she would require contact with the core of the Crystal Palace. With Mogoro Hagane. Subaru, isn't Mogoro one of the 9 Divine Generals? Vincent, yes. They have currently been put to rest in the Crystal Palace. Or, to be precise, the Crystal Palace itself has been put to rest. Subaru, you absolutely better explain this to me. Later on, saying this to Abel, who seemed to have many more secrets besides the Yang Sword, Subaru welcomed the decision that they definitely needed to go to the Crystal Palace. Subaru, to be honest, even though he knew that the core of the great disaster was in the Crystal Palace, he still wanted to confirm the safety of his comrades whom he had sent to the other battlefields. In particular, he wanted to check on the safety of Emilia and Tanza. Their placement was the only part that Subaru was not able to confirm. What was causing Subaru's anxiety and frustration was, golly, you're all looking like a mess. Even the Emperor San's forehead's covered in sweat and mud. He's a surprisingly hard worker, ain't he now? Suddenly, a black shadow descended and forcefully turned the situation upside down with a casual tone. The figure landed between Subaru and the incoming undead, walked over to them in a casual tone, and squatted down in front of Subaru and Beatrice. Then he laughed with a golden kiseru in his mouth and extended his folded hands. For all your hard workers. Here, gotcha some souvenirs. With that said, his folded hands were opened, and a number of strange crystals the size of coins were in his large palms. Subaru did not know what they were, but Beatrice, holding his hand, noticed. Beatrice, those are core bugs. Yepipe. The one from those guys. Nodding calmly, the figure brought his palms together again and rubbed them together with a scrubbing motion. In the next instant, the undead across the street let out a cry of anguish and turned to dust. The cores that had been reproducing the undead were thwarted, and they could no longer sustain their bodies. It was a tall, carefree black wolfman who did it in a flash. Subaru, Halibel-san. Halibel, ooh, ooh, that's such a warm welcome. I like energetic kids who can speak loudly. Halibel, who had been working separately, nodded at Subaru's surprised voice. He was asked to eliminate the most important opponent in the decisive battle for the Imperial capital, an enemy that had to be eliminated in order for everyone to give their best performance. The fact that he was here like this meant, Halibel, don't you worry, my work is done, taken care of. Got no intentions of letting Lil Anna's face be crushed after all. Subaru, dash. That's a huge help. Thank you. Can I count on you for to keep it up with something else? Halibel, you sure ain't a shy boy. Well, s'pose it'd be dandy, go on and say it. Subaru, I want you to go with me to the palace. I just want to leave you to cover the other girls on the way. I'll be working Abel to Point of Death over on our side after all. Vincent, disgraceful. Abel grumbled something about Subaru's suggestion, which he consciously ignored. At any rate, it was fortuitous that Halibel had accomplished his task. He was very anxious about Emilia and the others, but if Halibel were willing to go, it would make them even stronger and help Emilia bloom. Subaru, Olbart-san should be in the palace. That's why I want you to go to Emilia and Tanza. Vincent, hold on, Natsuki Subaru, is that a strategic decision? If that is not the case, Subaru, if that'll make you agree, then yeah it is. It's all part of my performance after all. Subaru retorted to Abel's interjections and glared at him. It was encouraging to have Beatrice holding Subaru's hand tightly as if she were on his side. Halibel interrupted the exchange of stern glances with a hold on. He put his bladed hand in between Subaru and Abel, as if to cut the thread of the staring contest, and, Halibel, ain't no need tar be so belligerent. And as for the fight around the palace, I think I ain't gonna be needed for it, okay? Subaru, huh? Subaru's eyes widened at Halibel's comment as he stroked the hair under his chin. The admirer turned his narrow, thread-like eyes in the direction of the gaze that sought the basis for his statement. Halibel, the power of love is mighty, I guess this is simply a case of that. And then, he laughed with a face that mixed equal parts amazement and admiration. An unthinkable scene was in the midst of unfolding. The woman, who had become unable to define whether she was Yorna Miss Higgia, or if she was Iris, all she could do was watch as she held back the tears on the verge of distorting her vision. Woman, Tanza, the name spun by those trembling lips, it belonged to the dear girl who housed a flame within a single eye, and with the hem of the kimono they once had chosen together fluttering, confronted the fierce advance of the undead swordsman. Far more agile and powerful than the Tanza she knew, it was a fight brimming with confidence. Tanza was once a girl without confidence in herself. She was incredibly intelligent and capable for her young age, and yet, the child had evaluated herself as being completely lacking, an evaluation that was far too low of herself. Back when she was the same age as Tanza in the truest sense, she had not been nearly as capable as her. A foolish child she was, getting carried away thinking it was her duty to fulfill the work entrusted to her so that she would not be a burden to her parents and the people of her village, and yet failing to notice the thoughtfulness of those around her. Compared to her past self, Tanza was far more admirable. And now, after believing that death had bereaved her of Tanza, they had been reunited in this situation where her own foundation had become uncertain. Between Prisca, the Empire, the Demon City, Tanza and Yugud, her mind was in its greatest state of turmoil throughout all of her lifetimes, numbering greater than 10. The only comparable instances that could come to mind were when she had first learned that she had been reincarnated due to a curse, when she had discovered that Prisca had survived, when she had been reunited with Yugud, and when Tanza, who had survived, had completely refused to listen to her. Woman, of late, there have been far too many. She wanted to lament the relentless series of shocks of this current life, however the present moment was far too hectic. As these various mental burdens continued, in order to protect her as she could no longer recover the will to fight, brazenly utilizing the effects of the soul marriage technique in addition to something else entirely, Tanza's back looked to be quite large. How much? Just how much had she gone through after they had been separated at the Demon City? Ever since Tanza had arrived at Chaos Flame with her sister Zoe, she had intended on being the one to watch over Tanza's growth the most closely. But, had she remained by her side, would Tanza's current self ever have come to be? Someone apart from herself, they had gotten close to Tanza, pushed her, and made her stronger. She could feel it within Tanza's intense gaze, in her gait, and in the fist that she had slammed into the swordsman's face. Tanza-chan. Tanza, yes, Emilia Summer, let us not give them any leeway. As her voice resounded in a manner resembling a silver bell, the silver-haired girl Emilia cooperated with Tanza. Her long hair fluttered as she swung her weapon constructed with ice to repel the undead swordsman, working in perfect sync with Tanza to support each other in both offense and defense. This was in spite of the fact that there should not have been much time for Tanza and Emilia to build such a relationship. Under the unexpected strength of Tanza and Emilia working together, the blue-haired swordsmen, the undead swordmasters, were smashed one after another, scattering fragments throughout their surroundings. However, swordmaster, sad to say, but seems there's a limit for your living folk. You sure wield your power with great vigor, but how long do you think that power's gonna last? Emilia, geez. Don't brag when you're cheating. His characteristic undead golden eyes shining, the undead swordmaster smiled provocatively, and Emilia fell for that provocation. She raised both hands and slammed them hard onto the ground, and in the next moment, while avoiding Emilia and Tanza, ice spread throughout the street in a manner akin to branches, entrapping the hands, legs, and torsos of the swordsman. That ice had an appearance just like that of a vine of thorns. Woman, uck, Tanza, yawn a summer. For a moment, she crouched down, clutching her chest as she felt an ache within. Caught a glimpse of that foolish action of hers in the corner of her eye, Tanza cried out her name in a scream. Even if momentarily, the fact Tanza's awareness had left the battlefield meant that, swordmaster, you gotta be greedy for victory, simple as that. Tanza, HK. A fierce front kick was unleashed, sending Tanza's petite frame flying backwards. Tanza's sprung up body flew, and at the end of its trajectory as it bounced, the figure of her own crouching self was present. She immediately raised her face and was about to call out Tanza's name, but what would that even achieve? It would have merely been another meaningless pull on Tanza's attention. Woman, Tanza, Tanza, yes, Yorna Summer. Responding to the cry that ultimately could not be held back, the bouncing Tanza readied her posture midair. Just prior to colliding, Tanza had managed to stop herself. That small yet large back of hers was just before her eyes. Thereupon, the undead swordmaster's merciless sword strike drew near, threatening to cleave the two of them in twain. Tanza, Emilia Summer. Emilia, yes. Without even a moment's hesitation, Emilia responded to the call, and Tanza swung her leg upwards. That upraised foot, freshly clad in a geta made of ice, caught the strike from the undead swordmaster's katana head-on. It was a pair of thick-soled geta, just like the ones usually worn by the flamboyant, Yorna Mishigia. Tanza, Tanza, having stopped the katana with the sole of the geta adorning her raised foot, had leapt upwards using the same raised foot as a starting point, and spun vertically in mid-air, slamming down the icy geta of the opposite foot onto the head of the immobilized undead swordmaster. She drove him into the ground. Then, with the head of the undead fell to the ground as a center, a crater of nearly 5 meters was caved into the street, and as the powerful blow turned her opponent to dust, Tanza waved the hem of her kimono. Woman, at Tanza's gallant appearance, all she could do was stare speechlessly. Having noticed her gaze, Tanza turned around, and slightly lowering the corners of her eyes, she smiled. Those lips had been about to call out to her with Yorna. Emilia, HK, no. That instant, Emilia, who was further away, thrust out both her hands, and with the screams of the freezing atmosphere, she sensed the presence of the two undead swordmasters being pierced by ice and turning into ice statues behind her. But she could speak no words of gratitude to Emilia. More importantly, Emilia needed to stop the barbaric act of another undead swordmaster who had appeared behind Tanza after she had turned around. No, she would not make it in time. Thus, there was no choice but to protect Tanza herself. Woman, I am. Numerous were the things she had overlooked, numerous were the things she lost, numerous were the people she had let down, and numerous were the lives she stood upon to be here now. Although until now she had been unable to repay even a single one of those among the numerous, for Tanza alone she could do so. Woman, taking Tanza into a tight embrace with her outstretched hand, she resolutely leaned forward with her upper body to protect her from the blade. She had moved skillfully. For just this moment, she was glad that she had not been her trembling and immobile self. Now, at least with this body of hers, taller and with limbs longer than the ones she had possessed before, she could protect this little darling, this dear child of the empire which that person had so carefully protected. To astonish myself thus, verily thou alone art able. That gentle voice, as sweet as if it had been whispered close to her ear, so calm that it was inconceivable for a battlefield raging with the gale of swords, resounded, melting her heart that had resolved itself for death but a moment ago in a manner that was difficult to believe. Woman, before the blow from the undead swordmaster's katana could connect, it was halted by the treasured sword of crimson that had been thrust in its path. And then, witnessing the presence that had brought that about, she could not help but gasp. Their reunion had been unexpected and unintended. She did not know whether to rejoice or to grieve, and ever since that moment, she felt like her heart had been torn apart. Ultimately, that question had remained unanswered, and the present moment had arrived. Only now, at this very moment, could she say for sure. Even when tensed, thy face is lovely, O star of mine. Woman, your excellency. HK, before the man who had stated so, while caressing her cheek with the hand opposite to the one that had blocked the enemy's attack before Yugod Volekia, with skin of flesh and blood identical to what it had been during his lifetime, and with a clear will housed within his eyes, containing the overwhelming flood of love and emotion, was a feat that neither Yorna nor Iris were capable of.